and tell you a few little things. Today, my dear Patita, he told me, what is it that's going on in this world which has made the hypocrisy grow to such a level that people invent any kind of lie just to make money by having another armed conflict involving the death of many children and women and so many people. Then another devotee also asked me a question. Not related to this directly, but she said that nowadays our preaching sounds different than in previous times. That we are talking about many issues which are related to our environment, to our dear Mother Earth, etc. So I reflected upon the two things simultaneously because they were both embedded like seeds into my mind today, and they were searching for some further development. So the number one is that after long talks with Gurudeva Tulananda about the future of the Vrinda mission, I'm just about to produce some very revolutionary ideas for the future of the Vrinda mission, which my work is not totally finished, but it may come up at any time soon. We were talking that our main duty today is to work on the education, to educate the devotees and the friends and the children in the best way possible that they can fare good in their journey of life, that they will have some success. So, education versus opening more temples, distributing more books, making more catering, making more this and this and this and that and that and that. Not that we are not going to open more temples when the opportunity arises. We may have to do that because that's just a natural growth of our movement. But we already know what that means in a way. We know many things, but we don't know all the things. So because we have to think about how our devotees will grow into the future, it's very important to have them well prepared. And that well preparedness requires from our side a deep research into what this well-preparedness really means. Oh, there's a lot of things to learn and a lot of things to do. Especially in the situation which we are in, the realistic scene of our temples. We have to see that the devotees learn how to relate to the public in such a wonderful way that the public will be attached to the devotees and their work. And that simultaneously, we can get some kind of sustenance, maintenance, by doing that same. Of course, I can send everybody to become a helper on construction site or to work in the pharmacy or in this job or in that. But there's other things that are peculiarly good for coaching humanity with love. I use that word coaching because it's in. So coaching humanity with love towards a better stand means also coaching ourselves into the ability to do so. And that has been on my mind, and that has changed my preaching style. I definitely recognize that. Plus, I'm also trying to make the devotees present within the world of different platforms. That also has changed some of my vocabulary. True. And I want to congratulate very deeply from the heart to our dear Haladhar Prabhu, because while he was absent yesterday, and we did miss him, he was opening the pavilion of the world religions in the Bundesgarten Garden Show. That's right, Bundesgarten Show. International Garden Show of Berlin, which is a festival which, my God, when I was a child, it was already going on. It's a very, very long established show. A show where you would not expect religion whatsoever to be involved. But in a very subtle way, and in a very deep way, as Haladhar is by nature, he introduced to all the people there in the pavilion a piece of art which they accepted, and he gave to them a piece of art which it is better to look at it than to describe it, but in the essence it represents the one and different teachings, Achintabheda Tattva of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, in such a delicate and artistic way that it was positioned in the very heart of this program, the very heart of this special pavilion. And when I saw it, I really could not believe it. I say, how was this chosen to be put in the heart? That Mahaprabhu's conception is capturing the heart of all the present religionists, because it wasn't like, oh, we were the first, we put it there. They all accepted that should be in the center for our concern. So Chaitanya Mahaprabhu really inspired a very wonderful contribution. So, and it is also the fruit of many years of interreligious work done by Haladhar Prabhu in the forum. Please take a notice of it, because in other cities you should also participate in the interreligious forums if you have a temple there. Please give a round of applause for this. When you go to Berlin, before you go, you can go there if you like. If you not, you ask for Haladhar to show it to you. Yes, the pictures. So, then coming to the second question, Ms. Patit spoke. And that is What is motivating people to openly disgrace themselves and their country and religious tradition by simply inventing lies which are soon to be caught, which involve the ruthless killing of so many human beings? What motivates a person to that? And the Srimad Bhagavatam has given the answer. The Srimad Bhagavatam has said in Kali Yuga, money is sweeter than honey. People, for the sake of making illegal, illicit earnings, which they can stuff into their bank accounts or into their pockets or in their cushions, they do not mind to be caught if they think the risk or the gain is sufficient. That's a very unpleasant thing. So we may ask ourselves, what can we propose to such people who are not even fearful to be caught? Of course, we believe in the law of karma, and we know that whoever does anything really nonsense, he'll have to pay for it. It's going to be a serious blockage of its own progression and a serious implication in unpleasant surprises coming up for him in his future. Of course, they will probably say, this future I do not believe in. I only believe in the present momentarily benefit, and I don't really care who are all these people who then think badly about me. There are so many instances in this later history of total lies being invented and top politicians going out in public speaking those total lies, which end up a week later in a war attack against the country, which now Syria, then Iraq, then Kuwait, all these type of places. For what we know well, our interests, monetary interests. Dr. Vandana Shiva, when she was in Miami, I went to her talk in the university, and boldly she declared, we need an earth without borders, because the dangers of one country lap over to another country, and we have to be earth citizens and identify with the welfare of everyone, otherwise this madness is going to go on. Then she said, the USA is a military dictatorship and no democracy whatsoever, and those allies of the US are extended dictatorships. Just they have a very sophisticated way of managing this dictatorship today, including with Facebook, WhatsApp, and so many other tricks up their sleeves, which are very, very amazing tricks. And in that management of tricks, They are going on to control anything and everything the way they want. So, Patti asked me, what are we going to say about this? How are we going to deal with such circumstances? As devotees, what are we going to present here? And the answer, which I can give from the core of my heart, is not surprising. It's called love. Love and forgiveness. Because these people who do these stupid things, they have simply lost their criteria of what's good for them. And they are deciding everything wrong against themselves for the sake of enlightening humanity. Because humanity has to see these mistakes so that they can change as well. When you see the biggest mistake, then more people can see it. Very small mistakes go unnoticed. So we are forgiving them and calling upon the world from the depths of our heart with all our love. Let's change for the better, step by step, one by one, smile by smile, forgiving by forgiving, and teaching, and that's what the Ohila World Peace Therapy is all about. We cannot counteract their nasty behavior in any other way. Because if you wanted to counteract that nasty behavior in a more nasty way, you would become the most nasty of the nasty. And this doesn't suit us. That's not what our brothers, sisters, grandfathers and grandmothers are proposing to us. They say counter the nastiness with love. Jesus Christ principle. And that's what Amit Goswami in his book Quantum Physics and his movie also The Quantum Pioneer explains, that when the egotist changes from egotist to loving his enemy, his opposition, then we can understand that there is a total change of paradigm, a change of consciousness. And that is our proposal, and it has been our proposal for a long time. But sometimes we forget it when we hear the nastiness of the political dealings and the consequences of it. So, how to love such people, how to spread love towards them to understand, or that people may understand, that this suicidal behavior of the nastiness is simply gonna backfire on them individually and on their nation as well. Just take for one example the image of the United States of America and their allies as well. In the world of sensitive people, in the world of loving and compassionate people, these countries have lost the respect entirely. And I can speak for that because I live in the South American countries, I live in communist countries and other countries, I live in India very often. I know what the people think about the US and their systems. Of course, They have managed to capture the world with Mickey Mouse and Hollywood. They have managed it. But Michael Moore, in his last movie of Conquering the World, has given some amazing proposals how he would conquer the world. If you haven't seen that movie, watch it. Did you see it?
Where to invade?
You love it.
Yeah.
Where to invade next?
Yes.
That's what else to invade? Where to invade next?
Yeah, where to invade next?
Where to invade next? Yeah, something like that. So, it is a question of finding the answers in the heart and not finding the answer in sophisticated weaponry or finding the answer in more sophisticated lies or finding the answer in a communication system which they set up to know everybody's mind. Don't forget, whatever you write on WhatsApp, whatever you write on Skype, emails, is immediately reported by the system of evaluation by words, whether there's anything questioning or criticizing the system of the power. In other words, there is nothing private anymore. Even your telephone calls are all listened to. I mean, when I heard these things, I thought, poor guys, they have to listen to so much stuff, you know, all the gossip. But matter of fact, that's what's going on. And our world has been exposed to such a tight control like never, ever before. So now is the time for love. Like Gandharvika was singing, it's time for love. And who's bringing love? Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. And how does he bring love? By chanting the names of the Lord. By chanting the names of the Lord, you will be free. That was Lord George Harrison's song. If you want to be happy, if you want to be free, chant the names of the Lord with love and forgive all who are so far away from the truth and the right choices. Now, you may say, Pati, this is a very shallow answer and that this is not covering a very broad spectrum of people who are anxious to hear answers and news. And this answer will not cover an internet page to create revolutionary waves. Nevertheless, that's what came up in my mind when I was meditating about the situation and the outrageousness of everything. Even the social media is full of criticism of the lies of the warmongers. They simply call it conspiration theories of the enemies without any rhyme and reason. But they are simply reacting. And poor Mr. Trump saw such horrible pictures of some horrible misuses in Syria that he could only push the button, shoot the rockets into there, That's what they deserve, even though we don't know who is going to be hit by the rocket. Something like that. Anyhow, we're living in this century and we are trying to hold up the light of Prabhupada. We are trying to uphold the dignity of Srila Prabhupada's mercy. We are trying to uphold the message of the divine lover of humanity, Bhaktivedanta Swami Prabhupada. We're trying to uphold the Hare Krishna chant in the world. I was just recently appointed by the Vishwa Hindu Parishad to be their representative for all of South and Central America. That was an attempt or a proposal I made to them so that we can establish the glorious contribution of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu on an official educational platform. Because our platform of education is neo-colonial lies. All they have spread around in the world about India, primitive, aboriginal, backward, and nothing good to offer. None of the great glories of India have been spread around the world in the educational system or in the communicational system. But anytime they can find something to poke their finger, oh, look the Indians. But nothing of the truth. They have not given even recognition that all their languages come from Sanskrit. They have not opened their universities to study the most famous scriptures, living scriptures like Ramayana, Mahabharata, Chaitanya Charitamrita, living scriptures which were composed many years back and they are still listened to by the people in India, everywhere around the country in the form of dramas and recitals and parabali kirtans, etc. None of the information which is given about India carries the essence of what India really stands for and Sanatana Dharma stands for. So I connected with these people. We are working for Vrindavan, we are working for the holy dhams, that is my main issue. But as a side issue, I thought, if they give me this assignment, as a matter of fact, we are just translating the book of the Vishwa Hindu Parishad about Hindu tradition, which explains everything, including the Acharyas, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, everybody's in there, of the history of India. We're just translating it to Spanish to hold it up as evidence of educational evidence, because if other information about you is distorted, you have to provide the proper information. Then you can say, now Lou, you compare these two and I tell you what is the truth of it. So all these things, they're part of our little contributions. And I hope, as Lord Krishna arranged it a few days ago, we were able with Sannyasi Maharaj to go to have a very nice program in the Indian embassy. And they told us they wanted repeated programs of that quality there. They requested us. So we have to elegantly prepare such programs that they will be accepted and increase the friendship with the Indian embassy and with the Indian community. That requires some brainstorming from the community. And it will be all for the better. For the better. Because once war starts, then we will know what it means to have lost the peace. But because the war has not crashed upon our heads here, we still think, oh, wie war das noch? Hehehe, bemerkte schlicht. Gott sei Dank, aber nicht für mich.
Fatal, fatal.
Wie war's?
Fatal, fatal, bemerkte schlicht. Aber diesmal nicht.
Ah ja, das war gute Erinnerung. Fatal, fatal, bemerkte schlicht. Aber diesmal nicht für mich. So, so in this way, you know, very sad. Observed Mr. Schlicht, but it wasn't for him, so he didn't really mind it. So this is what's happening in this world. We think it doesn't bother me. It's not cutting my income. I don't have to live without electricity and without water in a cold winter. I'm still fine. So we want more activism of sensitive people in the Berlin community who want, we just had a discussion with Satrika and with Rasa Lila and with Sam about our current condition in this, spelling out our position into this direction and what to do and when to do and where to do. And maybe we can have a further discussion on that with those inclined to such participations. When we went to Belgium, where Mumta Itu had invited for the rights, nature's rights, a meeting with the Parliament of the European countries, very amazing people were there who have done amazing things, like the court case against Monsanto was present there. Amazing people, and also from the parliament, amazing speakers were there, completely appreciating the point of view of the nature's right movement. But at that point we understood that we needed to have a team of activists who are ready. As a matter of fact, I promised that in August 2017, not far from now, there will be a court case against a few companies, including Bayer, in connection with the COP in Bonn. COP means the environmental, the heads of state coming in there. That is the right moment when the world attention goes to a certain thing. So, Valerie, organizer of this, she invited me to participate, and I promised her that we will be there at least with 6 to 8 people to help her to conduct this court case and to be a volunteers out there. We can have vegan sandwiches there. It's being born. So please, I made that promise. Let's think about it, how to do it. Because I don't want to promise something, not fulfill it. It's going to be a 1 or 2 day affair. And can you imagine, they're going to sue Bayer for all the nonsense that company is doing, which never really comes to court because of their powerful influence. The tribunal against such enterprises is an awakening tribunal. It has already taken place in Quito, Ecuador, Lima, Peru, Paris, COP21, and Den Haag in case against Monsanto last October, which the outcome is just in a few days is going to come. Volunteer our retired judges is a very high, a very solid contribution of the environmental movement. They are part of this, so it's very good. According to my understanding, it is first class. So we want to be part of this as much as we want to be part when in Berlin people are going to demonstrate against the mistreatment of animals. Anytime things go on which are really sensitive struggles for improvement of things in the world. So this is a little bit what I wanted to awaken you today with this little talk. I know you have no time. I know we are very few people. I know that very well, and as a matter of fact, that is a reason why we are so busy with everything else. We have no time for good things when it's necessary. So that is a problem we have, but as devotees, we have enough time to do wonderful things, and Bhaktivinoda Thakur gave the example of doing such things. Prabhupada dedicated his whole life to do good things for others. So it's not something which never been done. Now it's time to do. No. So now before I close here, because so many other wonderful things will take place tonight. Also want to announce that tomorrow we have initiations. Is it tomorrow? Is on the plan, yeah? Alala, tomorrow. So there are some devotees for second initiation. They should come to me and have a little talk. If you want to have the second initiation and for some reason you haven't gotten it yet. So we're going to plan these things tonight and tomorrow early. And welcoming a few new devotees and members of our family makes us very happy. Yeah. Anyhow, because we have some devotees already talked with me, so it's already done, but some have not talked yet, so time is running. And a happy Angira is also here. Radita. Haribol. And whoever else has come a little later today, So this is, do you have any questions? Is anybody interested to participate in a special environmental action group so that we can see who wants to be on the special assignment list? Here from Berlin, especially. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So please somebody take the names and invite them for when we figure out when to make this action group. We have to see when to fit it in with all the other programs. Haribol, any question? Yes?
I wanted to ask in regard of resistance against what we see in the world, like what's your opinion about to use, like we see in North Dakota with the Standing Rock, they were using prayer as a as a tool of resistance. And I just wanted to hear your thoughts about
that. That is a particular way natives react. Prayer and joint meditations as well. So this is a peaceful action. Anyhow, definitely, we pray every day for this. We pray every day for all the circumstances. One country just recently made a world, an all-country determination prohibiting gold to be taken out of the ground in that country. What country was that? Was it Costa Rica? Somebody read that? I read it just a few days ago. One country. Is it Costa Rica? Costa Rica decided no gold out of the ground. So that. We have a very strong environmental group working there with our devotees in Costa Rica. They have been for years out in all the activism with Dr. Vandana Shiva. Costa Rica has been the first country to prohibit GMOs in South America in most of their territory. So.
And the first country to let go their arms.
Any other question? Yes, Radha?
You talked about Facebook and so on, about social network, which are controlled as soon as we tip, some
email.
But now it's a level above. I don't know if you know, but now if you buy a new Samsung television, it works like Big Brother. Like you watch something. But they also watch you. It's a double, and the boxes, I don't know how we name this, where the sound come out, work also as microphone. But we just only know this for the Samsung television, but we have all now retina screens, so it can be that someone is also with us now because I have a new computer. So it's not just on Facebook. It's apparently, if you buy a new screen, it works like Big Brother. They are watching us.
So now we are all very famous.
Yeah.
Who?
Udava. How to be a good educator?
By example? By practice and precept. Following the greatest of the educators, keeping those above our head. I've seen so many beautiful kirtans here today. Drupadi was singing, Lalita was singing, Goloka Vihari was playing the drum with his joyful daddy face. Oh, my sweet Kirtaniyas. And yes, and so many seminars were held here today. I'm thankful that you're giving so much input here, so much creativity. Also welcome to Prabhu Ranchor. Many, many year temple president of Medellin. Anyway, this is a tough place. But by Krishna's grace, the devotees are active in Medellin for almost 40 years, preaching there non-stop, right in the middle of town. We have two big temples. One is called Govinda's, where Lord Jagannath is being worshipped, four-story building, right in the heart of town. And then there's Ganges, which is a Radha Kirakshora Gopinath Mandir, which is in another important place of Medellin. And on the way to the airport, there is Sachinandan, or the beautiful farm, the eco farm of the Medellin devotees. And many other smaller preaching centers also around. But these are the most important. Or in Bello. In Bello, there is also a very important temple. Anything else? Falta?
In Bigal.
Bello y Bigal no lo mismo? Son dos templos? In Bigal también. Okay, there's another new temple in Medellin City. Envigado, Bello, Ganga, Sachinandan, and Govinda. So it's five main temples in Medellin. Jai Srila Prabhupada. Sprichst du laut, bitte?
Ich wollte fragen, was eigentlich ein Mensch ist. Was ist eigentlich ein Mensch?
Mensch ist. Mensch ist. What's the human?
Ja, Srila Prabhupada hat manchmal gesagt, wenn jemand die vier regulierten Prinzipien befolgt, dann wird er wirklich ein Mensch im wahrsten Sinne des Wortes. Sonst gibt es auch zweibeinige Tiere, die nicht so wirklich den Unterschied zwischen Tier und Mensch in ihrem Verhalten mitverstanden haben und deshalb oft merkwürdig handeln. Aber wenn man die vier Prinzipien akzeptiert grundsätzlich, dann hat man sofort ein Grundverständnis von der Verantwortung des Menschen, nämlich etwas über höhere Wahrheiten kennenlernen zu wollen. So wird das beschrieben in den Schriften. Und mit viel mehr Details und mit viel mehr Einzelheiten, aber als grundsätzlich, um es mal so ein bisschen zu beleuchten. Ein Mensch ist eine großartige Gelegenheit, großartige Dinge zu machen und zu verwirklichen. Aber ein Mensch kann auch genau das Gegenteil machen. Einfach nur nach Macht suchen, um dann andere seinem Willen zu unterwerfen. Bist du damit zufrieden? Okay. Damit. Ja, noch eine Frage bitte.
Ich wurde heute gefragt, warum Krishna ausgerechnet eine Pfauenfeder als Kopfschmuck trägt und warum es nicht eine andere Feder ist, was es mit dem Pfau zu tun hat. Und ich konnte keine Antwort geben, weil ich das noch nicht in den Schriften gelesen hatte und würde das jetzt auch gerne wissen. Und, ja.
She wants to know why Krishna is using a beak feather. and not condor feather, adler feather, or any other feather. Well, I think that is because in Vrindavan there's so many peacocks. They are part of the scenery of Vrindavan, screaming beautifully in the early mornings, and everywhere in Vrindavan you can find peacock feathers, even today. And Krishna took one of them and put on his head. And he was very fond of them. The peacock, by being glorified by Krishna wearing his feather on his head, has also been considered the emblem, the emblem of beauty. If I'm not wrong, he's the national bird of India.
Yes, sir.
So not only Krishna liked him, but Bharatavarsha tradition has crowned the peacock as the national bird of this. I think because of Krishna. But when you see the peacocks, you can also see that it's hard to compete with them. They are something else. And for those who don't know that, peacocks, they drive away the poisonous snakes.
How? Sorry.
You want to know how? Yes, a peacock can fight with a snake and defeat the snake. It's amazing. Yes, Patti.
But isn't there a lila around this peacock feather? I remember something, yes. But I don't remember.
There's many lilas. Krishna is dancing like a peacock for the gopis. There's a special dance where he's all wearing peacock feathers and he's dancing like he's a peacock in front of the gopis. That lila is also there.
Not also the one with Radharani where they change forms? I do not remember right.
Sorry. Yes, Dinabandhu?
Yes, Maharaj, you are very much glorified, but I just wanted to add one more thing, why peacock has so much of importance. Because we believe that India is so merciful and graceful country in which we do enjoy all the seasons, whichever is available. And the seasons are beginning, that means from winter, autumn, summer, and the season begins with springtime. And spring, the nature starts glorifying. And any time when peacock starts to dance, because once you see the rainy clouds are coming, and the farmers see that peacocks are dancing, that means we also can start dancing because it's raining time. So peacock is a very, very symbolic representation that the vegetation will be coming and farmers can enjoy, because these clouds are not the symbolically black clouds, but they are getting rain with them. So peacock has a lot of great symbolically character, and once they start dancing, I have seen how beautiful it is, how amazing it is. Once you see a peacock dancing, he stops dancing, but he sees that you are observing him. And all of a sudden, that you are right. So all poisonous of surrounding peacocks runs away when he starts dancing. And he dances only for Krishna.
Hare Krishna. Malati.
I just have one remark to the topic you were talking about, that we should start the interreligious dialogue in our centers. So I just want to share the experience that in Prague we are cooperating with HWPL, which is a Korean organization which is working worldwide for peace, doing the acting to religious dialogue, and I wanted to tell we have really great experiences with them, because it's like I don't know who's sponsoring the organization, but they have it really well managed, and the people from this organization are really nice. So they are holding the meetings of different religions in different places, and then publish the results, and in some parts of the world they have quite good success in achieving peace through the religious dialogue. So if anybody wants more information regarding that, they can ask me. I think you have been on one of these meetings too, right? In Filipinas. Yeah, they remember you actually.
So, yes?
Ich habe nochmal eine Frage. Ich meine, wir reden ja über die Situation der Welt und es ist auch alles schlimm, es ist auch alles gut für mich. Aber es gibt halt eben auch die Sache, dass wenn ich hier keine Mahatma wie in Kali Yoga erscheint, dass das goldene Zeitalter auch beginnt. Was ist genau das goldene Zeitalter? Ist das ein Bewusstseinszustand oder findet das tatsächlich statt, dass in jeder Stadt und in jedem Dorf irgendwann getanzt wird und dass die Religionen sich vereinigen? Oder wie ist das goldene Zeitalter zu verstehen?
Ach, ich denke, wir lassen uns überraschen. Es wird davon gesprochen, ich habe davon gehört, dass 10.000 Jahre in Zeitalter und 10.000 im Abu. Oh, we will let ourselves be surprised when and where this illumination will manifest more solidly, but there are many indicators and many signs of some improvement and new searches appearing in the world. But we have heard that for 10,000 years since the appearance of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, that there's a time of influence of positiveness coming through his holy name. And I always sympathize with the devotees who asked that same question 60 years ago, 100 years ago, when there was no Hare Krishna movement around the world, there was nothing except a few devotees chanting Hare Krishna in India. If they would have asked that, and whoever answered them, I don't know what they answered, but nowadays, a few years later, the whole world is connected with Krishna in so many levels, small efforts, medium efforts, huge efforts, all over. I can only feel like, well, seems that something is on its way for improvement. And here we are, all of us, praying for that improvement. We want this improvement to be real. And we want many things to change, and we have many things to tackle. Anyhow, we have more days. 2 more days for studying more elements about it. But we are not only celebrating a Mela for 4 days or 5 days. We are celebrating a life of Prabhupada's grace 365 days a year. That is a lot of time to do, be part of that change. So I'll answer you in the name of Mahatma Gandhi. Be the change you want to see. Good?
Very good.
What was the question?
Shall we be the change we want to see? Is there any hope? He says he wants to know some more reaffirmation.